My name is Bill Priest, and I'd like to welcome you to the Community Pregnancy Center's 23rd annual Spring Benefit. This is our major fundraising event of the year. And we have invited and made the doors open to a lot of heroes tonight. And it's good to see each and every one of you here to be a part of this evening. Thank you for coming. I hope you enjoy what you're about to see and the ministry that goes on here. God bless you.
Until it's burning bright for you, it's everything that I desire. Can I be the one you use? And I am small, but you are big enough. And I am weak, but you are strong enough to take my dream. Come and give them wings, Lord, with you, there's nothing I cannot do, nothing I cannot do. I wanna feed the hungry children and reach across the farthest land. And tell them mercy there is healing, and mercy in the Father's hand. I am small, but you are big enough. And I am weak, but you are strong enough to take my dream.
Pastor James Irwin could not be with us this evening, so I'd like to introduce Pastor Rick Rufinock of the First Church of God in Defiance to open us with prayer. Pastor?
Why don't we all stand together? Let us pray. Our Father and our God, we come before you tonight, and we stand before you dedicating ourselves to this evening, that we might hear your voice, that we might feel your prompting. Lord, we believe tonight that you love life. You are the giver of life. And Father, we pray that you'll help us to be protectors of that life. Father, we ask for your presence tonight, that Father, you'll anoint our speaker, that Father, you'll be with every aspect of this evening, that Father, you will bring glory to yourself, and that Father, you'll give us an urgency for this great work. And we thank you for that, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Good evening. My name is Judy Van Wagner. I'm the Executive Director of the Community Pregnancy Centers, and I want to tell you how happy we are that you all are here with us tonight to enjoy this wonderful evening of information and challenge. We so appreciate your taking time out of your busy schedule to be with us tonight, and we have a wonderful evening planned for you, and I hope that it's the blessing that we were planning it to be. Now I'd like to thank some special people for years of service, and I'm going to go through all of them. I'm not sure if they're all here, so is Kelly here? Okay, all right. Okay, first of all, Cookie Lehman, who has been a board member for 5 years now. We'd like to tell her we appreciate her. This way. Yeah, you can come right through there. Don't bump your head. Linda Zachridge has been a volunteer at Defiance counselor for 5 years. Wanda Chokol has been a volunteer in Defiance for 10 years. And Wanda, you want to step over here and then we're going to let her get through so she can come through. And Sandy Potter has been a volunteer in Defiance for 20 years. She came just a few months after I did. And you can just step right over here. And lastly, Pam Roth, who has been a volunteer for 20 years, started out as a counselor, I think, for 5 years at Bryan CPC, and then has since been on the Speakers Bureau. So we would like to tell these ladies how much we appreciate them for their faithfulness. Believe me, longevity is not something you see much these days.
My name is Jessica Wasson, and I'm a freshman at Hillsdale College in Michigan, although I'm originally from this area, Bryan and Edgerton. So it is truly an honor to be speaking before you tonight, and I am here to share with you that I admire Project Respect, as well as the organization that makes it possible, the Community Pregnancy Centers of Northwest Ohio. This amazing educational program offers encouraging presentations to teens delivering factual information to equip them to make the right choices concerning sex. It promotes abstinence until marriage, an idea that seems to be turning into a very rare concept these days. I was introduced to Project Respect during my middle school years. One afternoon, a lady came into my health class to give us all the talk. I remember sighing in exasperation, fully expecting some type of Planned Parenthood nonsense. However, the presentation was far different than my initial expectations. Highlighting facts and sharing personal experiences, she informed us of the benefits of making wise choices during adolescence. Finally, there was someone in my school who was telling me that abstinence was the only choice that made sense. I will confess, I had already personally made abstinence my choice until marriage by the time that the presenter had arrived in my health class. God was gracious enough to give me Christian parents who raised me with solid, biblically based principles. Under their guidance, I discovered that remaining pure for my future husband was the only way to go. However, this choice certainly had not boosted my popularity in school. It was such a relief to hear another adult come into the school to explain the facts behind the myths of the media. I suddenly did not feel so alone, and I realized there were actually other adults out there, besides my parents, who cared about my generation. For many kids in that class, I am sure that that was the first time they had heard the truth regarding abstinence. Since attending Hillsdale College last fall, I've been exposed to a new atmosphere. There, most of the people I know are staunch supporters of abstinence. In addition, a Students for Life group thrives on campus. And although not all of the campus would agree with us, the strength and unity is certainly there. Abstinence is the path I have chosen because it is the only logical choice on multiple levels. One, I don't have to worry about contracting dangerous STDs. Two, there is no need to fear I will become pregnant and possibly ruin my future plans. Three, people can look at me and recognize that I value myself too highly through God's grace to give myself to someone with no commitment. Four, my future husband will know that I belong to him and no other. And five, perhaps most importantly, God tells us in his word that we should wait to have total intimacy before marriage. And I have seen demonstrated time and time again the complete ruin that befalls young lives when they turn their backs on his teachings. But with all these strong reasons to choose abstinence, as well as promote the program to future generations, Project Respect has already faced a dramatic blow, as Title V funding has been withdrawn for all abstinence-only education programs. Apparently, some government officials think that abstinence-only education programs do not work. A recent federal study claims that 1 in 4 teen girls between the ages of 15 and 19 have an STD. An article about the study stated, quote, "Some doctors said the numbers might be a reflection of both abstinence-only sex education and teens' own sense of invulnerability," end of quote. However, I find it interesting how these unnamed doctors believe that encouraging teens to not have sex results in more teens infected with STDs. Well, I stand here in direct disagreement with this farcical idea that abstinence contributes to the spreading of STDs. And I believe that people need to have the resources to know the truth about the consequences of having sex before marriage. Now is not the time to be turning our backs on teenagers by withholding the truth, for we need it now more than ever. Today's media has twisted and tarnished sexuality into something nearly unrecognizable from God's intended purpose. It is left to us to shine the light of truth into the darkest corners of our schools and communities. There are teens everywhere waiting to hear this message of hope. Project Respect and the CPC have taken this mission to heart, and I hope you will help them continue these amazing and desperately needed programs. Please help them promote what this world lacks so much, the truth. Thank you.
Thank you, Jessica. Boy, don't you all wish that you could hear this type of message from more of our college freshmen? Good job. I'm Shirley Brigeman, Director of Development for CPC and the Director of Project Respect. I'm eager to give you the brief update of what the CPC has accomplished this past year and share with you some of the hopes for the future. The big difference in this CPC from many others around the country is the emphasis on saving lives of both the babies and the mothers. There were 82 lives that were dedicated or rededicated to the Lord through the ministry of the CPC and Project Respect. And 183 lives of babies were saved that could have easily been terminated because of the difficult financial situations, bad relationships, fear of parents' rejection and anger, or just not being wanted. We know God uses this ministry to change lives one at a time, as you'll hear in the testimonies to follow. One of the exciting things that happened to the CPC at the end of this past year was the blessing of a new building in Bryan, and that includes now the business office, the CPC Counseling Center, offices for Project Respect, and enough room for a medical clinic as soon as we get enough funding for equipment and personnel. As you have made it, you might have read in the program tonight, there were many miracles coming from you, our heroes, to make that happen. Some of you have been over there for a quick tour, but we hope you'll all come to an open house that's tentatively scheduled for Sunday, May 4th in Bryan. And that's, the new location is on West High Street, and the landmark is, it's right across from Pizza Hut. So we have future plans for the Wasion Center too. Once the old Bryan building on Main Street is sold, we'll begin to gather funding for a larger facility in Wasion with enough space to have a medical CPC there with STD testing too. Another highlight of 2007 was the opening of our long-awaited STD testing site. The statistics are increasing, and the largest sector of those who have STDs includes teens and adults under 24. They're passing diseases during sexual activity, mainly because a lot of them don't have any symptoms. The only way they will know if they have one or more is to be tested. So in November, Dr. Tim Hogan, our STD clinic medical director, and Stephanie Lloyd, our nurse practitioner, approved the policies and procedures manual, and the doors were open for STD testing on Fridays at the Defiance CPC. The word is getting out, and even through our classroom presentations, we tell teens now that there is a place for free STD testing. Thank you for making that happen. We also hope to begin that in Bryan soon. One of our 2007 goals was to increase public awareness of our ministry. That meant taking a look at more and better types of marketing. More efficient advertising, a striking logo, colorful brochures, flyers in restaurants, more visible signage, and an appealing web page. And most of that has been accomplished. In fact, someone emailed us this past week about the new look of our website. They thought we had changed our mission. They asked if we were now promoting abortion. I don't know if you've taken a look at our website just this past week, but I want to take a minute to explain in case you would check it out and have the same question. In order to help women choose adoption or parenting instead of abortion, we have to reach them. We have to find better ways to reach the abortion vulnerable client. We know that if they come for an appointment and they have an ultrasound, they are more likely to choose life. When they see that tiny heart beating, they realize it's not just a blob of tissue. So we've been advised by pro-life marketing experts to give them a reason to come in. Therefore, our homepage says in bold print, "Considering abortion?" We don't say up front that we are pro-life, or they'll just click to another site if they're truly considering abortion. So we do have medically accurate information that they will need in order to make an informed choice. We give them some facts on the website, hoping that they will call us before they decide which option they will choose. But we have to get them in the door. Then through our sincere compassion and loving care, we pray that they'll want to learn more about their pregnancy and the truth about the options that they have to consider for their baby's future. But it starts with our web page for today's generation. Now, how many of you use Google as much as the phone book? We're changing our emphasis in advertising a bit. We're cutting costs and we're thinking long term. We put up some large billboard-type signs at various property locations around the four-county area, and this will make the general public more aware of the CPC, and they'll see the 800 phone number. The ongoing costs, once those signs are constructed, is practically non-existent compared to the huge Yellow Page costs. So if you know of anyone who owns commercial property on 6 or 24 or 108 south of Wasion, please ask them to consider letting us place a green CPC sign at the corner of their property. This is already bringing in new clients, and it'll save us dollars in the future, especially because we'll reduce our Yellow Page ads and we'll also cut out the newspaper ads. As you can see, we've been trying to make changes that will ensure the longevity of this ministry and save money in difficult economic times. We hope that some of you will even consider adding the CPC into your estate planning to help us continue the CPC legacy long into the future as well. And I've saved the best news for last. We have a new educational program for clients using our material assistance items as incentives. It's called Earn While You Learn. Doesn't that sound like a great idea? The clients choose topics from a curriculum on video, and they learn about life skills, relationships, parenting, money management, prenatal care, child development, and especially the spiritual topics. In the pilot program, we've been so excited about the number of clients who have accepted Christ during this program, and even some of their extended families. Women who qualify for government assistance may earn a new crib or a car seat by taking a required number of these classes. It's a blessing to them both ways. Learning empowers them to succeed, and earning gives them self-worth. It's been very helpful to our Hispanic clients, too, since we offer the modules in both English and Spanish. Recently, one woman delivered early, and she came back wanting to finish her classes even after she had her baby. Thanks so much for being here tonight, taking the opportunity to take an evening and just listen, find out more about the CPC. I want to encourage you to listen to your heart afterward. Do whatever you can to help us to save more lives in this next year. Our next volunteer training is in late April, 4 mornings starting April 24th. We really need volunteers, especially in Bryan and Wasean, and more people to commit to pray for this ministry, for the staff and volunteers, and especially for the clients and the hard choices they'll be making. Of course, we also need your dollars to keep the doors open. Because of all this sacrificial giving, we want you to know that you're our heroes. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Colleen Warren. When I was 8 years old, I had the traumatic experience of seeing my younger brother run over and killed by a car. It resulted in my blaming myself for this tragedy and having a very low self-worth. I didn't have a relationship with Christ, so in college I did many things that were wrong. After I was out of school, I met my future husband, and we married after 6 months of dating. While attending church with him, God performed a miracle. He saved me. Before our marriage, I wasn't really fully aware that Mike had an alcohol problem, but soon after we were married, I realized that he did. Our marriage wasn't what I hoped it would be, but I was too proud to leave and tell my folks I'd made a mistake. About a year and a half later, I was afraid I might be pregnant. I remember hearing my doctor say the test was positive and me saying to her, I can't do this. All I could think about was, how can I bring a child into the mess of my life? The doctor told me if I wanted to terminate the pregnancy, she would refer me for an abortion. Driving home, I didn't listen to the still small voice in my heart telling me God would be with me and everything would be okay. I told Mike I was considering an abortion. He told me it was wrong, but didn't try to talk me out of it. My best friend didn't try to either. My doctor set up the appointment, and the next week, Mike drove to the abortion clinic, dropped me at the door, and left for a drink. It was an excruciatingly painful experience. On the way home, I began crying so hard, Mike pulled the car over, but we didn't talk about what had just happened. I tried to forget about it, but not long after that, I was at his parents' house hoeing weeds in the garden. I accidentally killed a little frog that I hadn't seen in the sand. I felt terrible. But I heard that still small voice again saying, "You feel terrible about a frog? You took your own baby's life." For a year, I cried at night into my pillow before I asked God to forgive me, and amazingly, he did. But even so, I continued to push my abortion all down inside me, so far that soon it seemed as if someone else had done this. We never talked about it. It was as if it had never happened. Years passed, and though I thought God might never allow me to have another child, God blessed us with 2 sons in 2 years. Now, come ahead with me 15 years to 2006. I attended the CPC Spring Benefit and then the Volunteer Training Seminar. There was a lot of information about abortion during those 4 mornings, and I began thinking about it again. I thought about the years I'd spent fearing someone would find out what I had done. Then last spring, our church women had a monthly meeting, and one of the ladies blurted out that she'd had an abortion over 20 years before. She knew God had forgiven her, but she hoped her baby could forgive her too. Everyone showed her their support, and I offered her some CPC brochures. Soon God began speaking to me. He asked me, "Are you going to let your sister go through this alone, knowing you've been through it too?" Finally, I asked her if we could talk, and I told her everything. We agreed to pray for each other. I told her God was beginning to ask me to do things that were way out of my comfort zone. He told me I was to tell my church about my experience. But Lord, after 26 years, why? They won't feel the same about me anymore. My mind kept the arguments coming about why I couldn't do this. His voice was gentle, but insistent. And finally, I surrendered. I told them my whole story. It was one of the hardest things I've ever done, but they met me with open arms of love. Later, I went to the CPC and signed up for the heart post-abortion class. For the first time, I was made to look deep inside and to unlock doors that had been closed for 26 years. I was asked to examine myself with complete honesty and experience emotions that I had not allowed myself to experience. I had to search my heart for any unforgiveness toward anyone. All the if-onlys came to the surface. If only I had had a doctor who was pro-life. If only my best friend had told me to wait instead of trying to be sympathetic. If only Mike had tried to stop me. If only, if only. If only I had listened to God when he told me everything would be all right. He healed my husband from his alcoholism the very next year after the abortion, eliminating the main reason I'd had for doing this terrible thing. Bottom line, though, the only one I really had a hard time forgiving was me. But I was finally able to find even that forgiveness through the heart group. With God's grace and Sue Short's help, I saw my child finally as real as my son. At that point, I began to grieve. It was a blessing from God to be able to finally grieve for my lost son. Now I can say I'm a mom of three. Two are here with me, and one is in heaven and now deeply missed. The blessing and healing this has brought to my life can't be told. At the end of our classes, we had a memorial service for our aborted children, a very important part of the healing process. The next day was my volunteer day. I was asked to do some house cleaning at the CPC, and I started with the room where our heart group had met. As I began working, the thought came, how fitting this is. The tears that were shed here, God used to open closed doors and clean out all the dark corners of my life. His voice spoke back to my heart. It's no accident that you're cleaning this room today, my child. Then he said, I love you. Tears came as I said, oh Lord, I love you too. I will be forever grateful to the CPC, and most of all, to my Lord and Savior, for the healing I've found in the heart group after my abortion experience. It has enabled me to serve him better and with a joy only he can give. I thank him for his mercy and grace. I thank you for helping to make this wonderful program available to those of us who need it. We are everywhere. Because of your contributions to the CPC, not only are you saving babies and helping their mothers to see Jesus through you, you are helping women and men like myself that have been through this to heal. From the bottom of my heart, thank you.
Good evening. My name is Lydia Torres, and it's a great honor for me to be here to share the story of one of our clients. But for this, I must begin with my own story. In November of 2004, I was told that my administrative position had been eliminated, and I had to make a decision as to what to do next in my life. This was a very big decision for me to make. For some time, I had been feeling a stirring that God was moving me to do something more for his kingdom. But what was it? On Sunday, I went to my church family and asked them to pray on my behalf for wisdom. The peace that passes all understanding became my constant strength. And in December of 2004, I walked away from 23 and a half years of full-time employment, unsure of what was ahead, but feeling in my heart that God was leading me through the next phase of my life and the plan for me. I took the CPC training, and in May of 2005, I started volunteering at the Wasion Center. As an associate minister and very active in my church, I was used to seeing the needs of others, but now it was outside of church walls that my heart was opened to visibly see the needs of so many women who are without God in their life. And as I continued my work with the CPC, I began to serve Hispanic women in the language that they could understand. In October of 2006, I was asked to help a client in the Bryan office who was facing a crisis situation and needed to be counseled and prayed for in Spanish. Close to the end of the 6 weeks of working with this client, I was approached again by the Bryan staff to work with another Hispanic client. Her name was Rosie, a 16-year-old who wanted an abortion. I was told that Rosie had been referred to our Defiance Center to meet with Julie Hagen for an ultrasound, with the hopes that with God's intervention and Julie's compassion and expertise, this unborn child would be saved. By now, I had a part-time job that averaged 4 to 6 hours a week, but I really didn't have the gas money to go from Archibald to Wasion on Mondays and to continue going to Bryan on Wednesdays. I couldn't do it. On my way home, I cried my heart out to the Lord, for I knew that this 16-year-old needed my help, and how could I give it? The following week, I went to Wasion with my mind made up. I was going to stop volunteering at the end of the year because financially I needed help for the family income. Our two daughters were in college. Our son was in high school. It was too much for my husband alone. When I communicated my intentions of leaving to Wanda Roth, my office manager in Wasion, she showed me a projects list that had recently been developed by the board and staff during a workshop retreat. She explained to me how, after prayer and discussion, they had agreed that the Holy Spirit was leading the CPC to extend the ministry to reach the Hispanic community. I knew God was speaking to me. Later that week, I returned to Bryan to meet with Rosie. She shared me her story. Her biggest wish when she turned 15 was to come to the United States to visit her brothers and sisters. Being the youngest of the family, her parents had decided against it until now. On her way to being reunited with her siblings, she first came to California. One night, there was a party at the home she was staying, and the next morning, one of the persons living in the home informed her that a man was seen leaving her room. How could that be? She didn't remember who that man could have been or why he would be in her room. She didn't even know anyone there. She was horrified by the incident, but glad that she was soon going away, far away, to Bryan, Ohio, to be with her sister. Shortly after her arrival to Bryan, Rosie discovered she was pregnant. It had probably been a drug rape. Now she was the victim of rape and pregnant. With tears, she told me she didn't want to be pregnant. But the ultrasound from the Defiance Medical Clinic, from the CPC, had shown her that her and her sister, the baby. Rosie was hurt and angry with this great country that everyone seemed to think was so wonderful. How could she raise a baby whom she didn't know who the father was? How was she going to tell her parents and her brothers? I could see that Rosie felt so much shame and pain. The Holy Spirit brought me under conviction. I needed to help her. Rosie needed to know that God loved her and her baby. I gave her a Bible I shared God's plan of forgiveness and salvation through Jesus Christ. We read scripture together, and I wrote all the verses down for her in the front cover of her Bible. She repeated after me as we prayed for Jesus to come into her heart. That day, I said my own prayer of repentance, for I knew God wanted me here, serving in this ministry. Not only did Rosie accept Christ, but she accepted the challenge of raising a child. For 7 weeks, I worked with Rosie, preparing her for motherhood and teaching her the word. Her sister also accepted Christ. And on January 8th of 2007, Rosie gave birth to a beautiful baby girl who now lives with her in Chicago. Today, I proudly stand before you as an extension of your hands to serve on your behalf as the Hispanic liaison for the Community Pregnancy Centers of Northwest Ohio. Not only to use my Spanish to educate these women so that they can earn cribs, car seats, diapers, and other things for their babies, but also to give them Jesus, the gift for eternity. God bless you for your prayers and support. Gracias.
This song just simply says thank you to all the heroes in the room. Someone who's always there. What can you say to a hero? To someone who lives life to care. For all you did and do, we've seen your light shine through, and we are all blessed too.
You are our heroes. You are our heroes.
Fortunately for all of us, Stephen Mansfield prefers to be introduced simply because he is, in truth, a simple man. So introduce simply. He also worries that if his introductions get too grandiose, God may require him to live up to every word. So suffice it to say that Stephen is a New York Times best-selling author, a celebrated speaker, the director of a highly successful research and publishing firm. Most of all, he's a father, a poet, an unashamed racquetball addict, a Christian, and a man ever on the mend. Will you please join me in welcoming Stephen Mansfield?
How you doing this evening? Are you there? Are you all right? Having a good time? I was feeling pretty welcomed, actually, until somebody put this note in my pocket while we were shaking hands. It says, "Don't go long, American Idol, we know where you're staying." So I won't go long. I don't know what you're threatening me with, but I won't go long, I promise. It's great to be with you this evening. Man, have you had a chance to tell Judy and her team how much you appreciate them? Man, what a great bunch. Unbelievable. I want to cut right to the chase this evening because I'm excited about what I'm going to share with you and excited about how it merges in with the theme of heroes, one of my favorite themes. And so let me just get right to it. I had an experience not too long ago that reminded me of a number of experiences that I've had, but particularly one that I had in junior high school. And I want to share it with you just briefly because it so galvanizes what's going on in our generation. And I'm a lot about what's happening in our times. And I want to challenge you with some things this evening. When I was in junior high, my mother took me to see a movie. You've probably all seen it, Dr. Zhivago, based on the great Boris Pasternak novel. And I remember sitting as a 13, 14-year-old in the movie theater, raining outside. And those of you who have seen this movie know that one of the characters, Lara, in the movie, says at a time of great turmoil and upheaval during the Russian Revolution, says something like this: "What a horrible time to be alive." And I remember what it felt like for that to wash over me. For the feeling of someone believing that the time in which they live was a horrible time to be alive. I was an adolescent. I didn't need any help believing it was a horrible time to be alive. You know what I'm talking about. Girls, it's the whole thing. You get me. But I remember that. I remember very keenly the darkness and the sense of just almost cursing your times. Well, not long ago, I was in a hotel room. It's where I tend to spend a lot of my time. And I was watching CNN. Now, I know, I watch Fox, too, but I was watching CNN. Get off me already, okay? Everywhere I go, I'll be on my case. I was backslidden, and I was watching CNN, okay? It's the best thing I can tell you. And one of the announcers looked into the camera, and with these sort of Bambi eyes, began to tell us all the things that are wrong with our generation, all the things going wrong. And there are some things that are difficult now. I'm sure they were talking about hassles in D.C. and gas prices and the airlines. And believe me, I don't need any help believing the airlines are all going to hell in a handbasket. And all the things that you can imagine, complaining about the Bush administration, complaining about this, complaining about that. And finally, this commentator looked into the camera, Bambi eyes, painted by Disney, and said, "What a horrible time to be alive." Now, my friends, one of the great privileges of my life is lecturing, being a guest lecturer and adjunct faculty at West Point. And while I've been there, I've learned from some of the professors and some of the commanders that there is a military manual that's used all over the world in all the military academies. It's called, I'm sure some of you have read it, The Art of War by Sun Tzu. All the military academies use this manual. And in this manual, Sun Tzu, this ancient man, this ancient strategist, military strategist, says that the greatest way to defeat your enemy is not to defeat him on the battlefield, but to so discourage him that he will not show up for what would otherwise be very winnable battles. And my friends, I want to suggest to you that a combination of the flesh, the devil, and the world in our generation is trying to convince people like us that this is a horrible time to be alive. But my friends, it's a lie. This is a magnificent time to be alive. This is a treasure. This is a tremendous time to be alive. Have you considered what's going on in our generation? I mean, I realize that we've got tension and strife and argument, but have you considered what's happening from the perspective of people of faith in our generation? We've got a presidential election going on right now that looks like an election for pastor. There is so much discussion. I mean, I've seen pastors elected with less discussion of religion than we're having in this presidential election. I mean, I don't care what your political persuasion is. The reality is people are talking about the important stuff in this election, aren't they? A religion and faith and who believes what and whose chickens are coming home to roost, who, where and how. All of that's important stuff. I open up a copy of U.S. News and World Report, a business magazine. What do I find? An article about the archaeological discoveries confirming the Gospels of Jesus. This is U.S. News and World Report. I go to the movies. What do I find? Films like The Passion of the Christ and Amazing Grace. I have a very light connection to the Oscars. There was literally last year a discussion of an Oscar for a Christian film made in the basement of a Baptist church in Georgia. Do you remember this? Unbelievable what's happening in the arts in our generation. I mean, there is such a surge of faith, such a hunger of people wanting to understand life and reality in terms of the supernatural. It's astonishing. I mean, we are breaking records in terms of impact on this country. It's just that nobody's talking about it. For example, a few years ago, I wrote a book. It was called The Faith of George W. Bush. Should have been a big hit. It sold 1.6 million. That's pretty good. But it happened to come out the same year as Purpose Driven Life. Purpose Driven Life has sold 43 million copies. Most of those outside of the four walls of the church. Did you hear what I said? Most of that is being sold to people who aren't in church or people who are doing businessmen's Bible studies or whatever. I told Rick Warren and his publisher at a lunch that he's either a man of God or the Antichrist. I still have not forgiven this man. I've been in therapy for years. I've still not forgiven. I sell 1 million. Okay, I'll move on. Unbelievable the things that are happening. It's astonishing. Not long ago, I'm at the White House. The president gets off Marine One, his chopper, walks down to a rope line of reporters and puts his hands in his pockets and rocks on his heels like any West Texas rancher, and proceeds to tell the press what he's praying about that day. And without any other comment, turns and walks into the White House. Now, I don't care if he's your political choice or not, but when the president gives his prayer list to the press, something's changing in America, and I'm thankful for that. I know we have some difficult economic times. I know some things are happening that are difficult. But I want to tell you that those are the micro trends. The macro trends are phenomenal in our age. And for people of faith who want to impact a generation, lead people to God, and change the society, this is a glorious time to be alive. A glorious time to be alive. I was on the air not long ago, and they asked me, what is this age in which we live? What terms would you use to describe the age in which we live? And a phrase came to mind that I've written about and talked about before, but I hadn't intended to say it that day and hadn't really thought about it in those terms. And it was this, that we are living in an age fit for heroes. And I want to take a few moments to define what I mean by this, because you will not understand what I mean tonight and what Judy and her team means if you are using the word heroes in the traditional way. You see, the word hero had fallen out of fashion in our society, hadn't it, back in the 1960s and 70s, and excuse me, all of that sort of disillusionment during the 60s and 70s with Vietnam and so on. Really, Ronald Reagan brought it back in the 80s. Remember how he'd make a speech and he'd point up in the gallery and he'd say, this public school teacher or this policeman is an American hero, and you know, all the Congress would applaud. He really brought that word back. And then, of course, 9/11 certainly brought the word heroes back. Men and women who raced up into the buildings and lost their lives or rescued people at the Pentagon or all of that. We know that 9/11 was sort of a restoration of the word hero. As noble and as wonderful as that is, and as much as we ought to honor those who serve us in uniform, the fact is that the biblical word for hero means something different. And I'd like to share with you what that is and then give you a couple of illustrations. 137 times in the Old Testament, there is a word used that in your Bible is translated something like mighty warrior, mighty man, that kind of thing. Liberal translations, mighty mouse, whatever, just all kinds of. And I had to go there, sorry. I was a Republican demon got on my back. I'll shake it off. And so throughout the Bible, this word is used. Well, sometimes it ought to be translated mighty warrior, and sometimes it ought to be translated, you know, mighty man. But sometimes it ought to be translated hero. Now, you ask the young today what the word hero means or who their heroes are, what are they going to tell you? They're going to tell you a sports figure. They're going to tell you Usher or 50 Cent or some rapper or some music star. They're going to tell you somebody who's talented, visible, talented, rich, or famous, basically. That's what makes a hero to our generation, for the most part. The biblical word for hero does not have anything to do with being visible, being wealthy, or even having talent. The biblical word for hero means this. I'll give you several different kind of definitions along the same theme. The biblical definition of hero means somebody who lives in such a way that those who come after them can arise to their best because of the way this individual has lived. Said another way, a biblical hero is someone who breaks through a barrier in their generation so that others can come through that breakthrough, can come after them, and fulfill their destiny in a way they never would have before. Let me give you two illustrations so that we really hone in on what this means. As far as we know, no one ever ran the mile in faster than 4 minutes before 1954. Men talked about it. We have the records of the Olympic Games from earlier ages. People wrote about it even in the ancient times, a record of approximately that length. And nobody, so far as we know, had ever done it. But people wrote about it as being the impossible barrier. In April of 1954, an Oxford medical student by the name of Roger Bannister, trained in some unusual ways, and in April of 1954, he broke the four-minute mile. You go back and look at the newspapers at that time, the news shot all over the world, people went nuts, the pundits were writing about it. Somebody had run the mile in less than 4 minutes, and almost immediately they began to ask this question. You know how the press is, they'll ask these questions almost in a big gaggle. Can it ever be done again? Is Roger Bannister some kind of freak, and it will never be done again? Do you know that 3 months later, another man on another continent broke the four-minute mile? Do you know that by the end of that year, three men on three different continents had broken the four-minute mile? And I have stood on a high school practice field on a Tuesday afternoon and watched an 18-year-old, a senior high school student, break at the four-minute mile. It's not completely commonplace. God knows I can't do it. But everybody in the recent Olympics who ran a distance approximately a mile ran faster than a four-minute mile pace. But someone had to do it first. Someone had to show us what was possible. Someone had to break through the barrier and show their generation what could be done. And then it began to happen with regularity. Others could fulfill their destiny, could achieve beyond what they had imagined because somebody broke through a barrier. Future generations were changed in this sports illustration. Let me give you a silly illustration. You probably can't tell because I'm up here on stage and you're down there, but I'm quite tall. I'm actually 6'5" tall. And I have been over 6 feet since I was 12 years old. Let's pause for a moment and feel my parents' pain in trying to keep me in clothes and what have you. Before I was 12, earlier on, I was tall, but I wasn't, of course, 6 feet or over. And I remember once the kids in my neighborhood decided that they wanted to play tent. Wait for it. And they couldn't find a tent pole. So they went and got a nasty old tarp, bunch of military brats, there's always a tarp around, went and got a nasty old tarp, and while they played Army or Cowboys and Indians or who knows whatever, I played tent pole. Standing there with this nasty tarp over my head, thinking, just probably in my idiocy, thankful to be part of the game, you know, while these kids played their game. Now, it's a silly illustration, but it is exactly what the Hebrew word means. Because I stood up to my full height, the definition of a hero biblically, others could stand up to their full height. That's exactly what the Hebrew word means. You understand? A hero, Isaiah 3 is an example where this is used. In fact, in Isaiah 3, it literally says when God is angry with Jerusalem and Judea, he's going to take the hero away from them because he knows that the heroic dynamic in a society is essential for its strengthening. When he's judging in Isaiah 3, Judea and Jerusalem, he takes the heroic away from them. A hero is someone who stands up to the full capacity of what God's made them to be, lifting barriers, breaking canopies, breaking through barriers, and thus allowing others to arise to a destiny and a height that they never would have otherwise achieved. That's what a biblical hero is. And my friends, I want to tell you that I believe with all my heart that there is a heroic element to the callings on each one of your lives. I do not believe that heroes are people who necessarily grace the cover of People magazine. They may. I do not believe that heroes are people who necessarily make it into the newspaper. They may. But I believe many of God's heroes are people who are never famous, never noted, but people who change the generation that comes after them because they have lived in exceptional ways by virtue of prayer and generosity and character and the way that they have lived. In my family, I come from a long line of KKK Grand Kluxons and Grand Wizards and racists until my father went into the United States military and said, that's it. This stuff stops. He gathered his Georgia family. He said, I don't want to hear the N-word. I don't want to hear any of this stuff. This stops in our generation. And I want to tell you that he actually went into the military and helped turn the military in some of the racist attitudes that were happening in his generation. And oh my Lord, now when my family gathers for Thanksgiving, it's like a meeting of the UN Security Council. We have got African Americans, we have got Russians, we have got French, we have got Arabs. I think he overdid it. The only thing that we fight about is what animal to cook at Thanksgiving. People want a lamb, people want a deer, people want all kinds of things. Unbelievable. But someone had to stand up. If you're the first one in your family to say this anger, raging thing, this rage that comes down through the family line is not going to affect my children, that's a heroic stance. Do you understand what you're doing? You're saying thus far and no further, you're breaking a barrier, you're changing what comes after. If you're the first one to say alcoholism will not have my family line and you break it in your generation, then you're living a heroic life. Do you understand what I'm saying? You're not on the cover of Newsweek, you're not on CNN or Fox, you're just simply doing what God has called you to do in your generation. That's what a biblical hero is. Someone who lives in such a way that they break through a barrier, that they somehow lift a canopy, lift oppression, so that those who come after them can arise to their best. Now, I know what happens when I start talking like this. I know what happens. I talk like this a lot. I like to inspire people to achieve their destiny. I like to inspire people to heroic living. I love being part of this with these words. I love it. But I know what people do. We sit out there and we hear these challenging words, and what do? We begin to think of the reasons that we are not qualified to live an exceptional life of heroism and impact. We begin to think of all the things that disqualify us. Maybe we've been divorced, or maybe we've had a criminal record, or maybe we didn't get out of high school, or maybe, you know, who knows what, we had a business failure, or maybe there were other kinds of problems. And I want to tell you, as a man who teaches history at the university level, who loves history, that one of the reasons we think like that, one of the reasons we go through these lists in our minds of reasons we can't achieve great things, and we let the garbage we hear in the news talk us out of the greatness and the impact that we're called to in our generation, one of the reasons is that often we don't know the greatness of God, but also we do not know the lives of the great ones who have come before. The way that history is taught in our schools, you would think that the great and the famous and the heroes past fell from the womb perfect and became heroic statues 30 minutes later. I mean, it's unbelievable the way that we approach these things. Tell me who this is. The person that I'm thinking of, and this is typical, a flawed person who nevertheless achieved greatness because he overcame his flaws. Who is this? This man I'm thinking of was born a fat stutterer. I know all babies are fat. I'm just saying. It's a phrase that works. It rhymes. A fat stutterer. And his father hated him. Hated him. He did horribly in school. When he became an adult, he was in debt every single day of his adult life. He had a troubled marriage, one child died in infancy, one child committed suicide, two children drank themselves to death. He made mistakes while he was in office that threw his whole country into chaos, and because of his father's hatred for him, even when he was the leader of his nation, he would not stay in a room with a balcony on it because he was afraid a black dog depression would hit, that was his phrase, and he would be tempted to throw himself off that balcony. Now, who am I talking about? I'm talking about Winston Churchill, the greatest leader of the last century. You would not let him mow your yard if you had known all that about him. And he led the Western world, as you know, to greatness. I mean, it's unbelievable what we don't know about people. How many of you are in here are Methodists and willing to admit it? Is there anybody in here? I see that hand, brother, right over here. I got another hand right here. Let's all bow. Let's talk about John Wesley, the man who led England in revival that kept it from a French-style revolution. Some of us think that we're disqualified from accomplishing great things because our marriage is not the movie version of a perfect marriage. John Wesley's marriage was so bad that when a friend went to his house to pick him up for a preaching mission, his wife, Wesley's wife, this friend, found Wesley's wife dragging Wesley around the house by the ponytail. The woman used to go to his meetings to heckle him. That's how much she hated him. I can see pastors' wives in this room going, Secular and Methodist historians have all, both together, concluded that one of the reasons that John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, rode tens of thousands of miles around England preaching revival is that he didn't want to go home. And how about Abraham Lincoln? Surely he's a hero, the great liberator, the great president through the Civil War. Excuse me. The great man. When Abraham Lincoln was supposed to marry Mary Todd, he got so freaked out, he left her at the altar. When they went to find Lincoln, he was laying in bed with a pocket knife contemplating suicide. This is not a marriage destined for greatness. 15 years later, this is absolutely true. 15 years later, a carpenter comes to the Lincoln home, has to deal with Mary Todd, who was, by the way, a certifiable loon, has to deal with Mary Todd, finally goes to complain to Lincoln. Lincoln listens, puts his great big rail splitter hands on the man's shoulders and says, "Surely you can endure for 15 minutes what I have endured for 15 years. That's the truth. We're talking about Abraham Lincoln, the guy sitting up there in Washington, down there in Washington, over there, wherever it is we are. You understand what I'm saying? I talked earlier about movies that have had an impact on our generation. Unless you've been on Mars, you know that one of the most important films of our time has been The Passion of the Christ. Before it is through with its run, it'll be the most watched presentation of Christian truth since Jesus came out of the tomb. I was in the Middle East not long ago. It was the number one film in the Muslim world. made by Mel Gibson. We're talking about Mad Max here. Mel Gibson. Mel Gibson was a hard-drinking Australian bloke known for impregnating his co-stars and getting drunk and blowing the budgets of all of his films until he found some meaning in faith. God knows he's still not perfect, by a long way. Found some meaning in faith, changed his life, got relatively stable. Somebody should keep him out of Malibu. And began to make films that I think are some of the finest films of our generation. In fact, if you don't get up in the morning, I'm not sure you're going to heaven unless you've seen Braveheart. Come on, at least the airline version of Braveheart. If you don't get up in the morning and you don't look in the mirror and say, I'm going to paint my face blue, strap on my kilt, and storm the British of my generation, you're not alive. You're just not alive. If you were God, would you have chosen Mel Gibson? No, but he's making a difference in our generation, not intimidated by his flaws, despite them, overcoming them. And how about our president? May I talk about him for a minute and you not think that I'm being political in any way, because I'm not? I had the privilege of writing this book on Bush, and we went out to Midland, Odessa, Texas, and did the research on him. When you go out there, what you find out is that George W. Bush, the word they use of him most was a lightweight. He was the drunk at the end of the bar who thought he was increasingly funny the more whiskey he drank. People would walk into Red Lobster, see Bush in the restaurant, turn around, and walk out. That's what was going on in Midland, Odessa. Well, you know the story. He came to his 40th birthday approximately and had an experience walking a main beach with Billy Graham and some other influences. And he had what he calls a born-again experience. You don't know about this, there are one or two good books out on the market you might want to pick up. Deal with that particular subject. Just for your enlightenment, I thought I'd mention it. 12 years later, he was the Republican nominee for President of the United States. Some kind of gravitas, some kind of meaning, purpose, vision had entered his soul. Something that took him from the drunk in Midland, Odessa, to President of the United States. Now listen. I'll leave it to the ladies as to whether he's the best looking president we've ever had. He's certainly not, and I mean no insult, he's certainly not the most intelligent president that we've ever had. I mean, his test scores were higher than anybody he ran against. Oh, I shouldn't have said that. But he's not the most intelligent president we've ever had. And God knows he's not the most articulate president that we've ever had. Does it bother you if I say that? I mean, I write speeches for the guy. Can you feel my pain for just a moment? I still don't know what strategically means. Do you? I don't have a clue what that means. What does it mean to take the high horse and the low road? I don't know. And it was inserted in my speech. I have spent time with the president. I wanted to fall to my knees and say, sir, please speak any language I know. One of my commentators in D.C. says that listening to George W. Bush make a speech is like watching a drunk man cross an icy road. You just want him to get to the other side. I told the president that a little bit later. He goes, yeah, that's about right. That's about right. He doesn't even care. Flawed men. Flawed. Troubles. Wives, husbands, fallen people, nitty-gritty, accomplished greatness, not because they were somehow exempt from the hardships that I listed earlier that are going through some of our minds, thus disqualifying us for the heroism to which we're called. No. I would suggest they arose to greatness because, as they overcame their flaws, they developed the muscles of character that allowed them to achieve greatness. What Churchill gave to the world, he first acquired overcoming in his inner life. Now, why do I say that? I say that, my friends, because I believe, despite what the news is telling us, despite some of the trends that may scare some of you about politics and about economics and about terrorism and about wars and what have you, despite all of this, this is an amazing time to be alive. And the great damage that we are aware of in D.C. is that this nation is going to talk itself into crises it doesn't actually have. What we need are some people who start to live for a higher purpose than just survival. What we need are a people who start to live in terms of the next generation. One of the stories that bothers me the most in the Bible is where a certain king of Israel shows Babylonian envoys and people who are visiting, shows them the wealth of his kingdom. And when a prophet comes and says, your children, because you've disobeyed God, your children are going to be taken away, and everything you've built up is going to be passed into the hands of a pagan king. This king, who's supposed to be caring for the land and caring for the next generation and caring for his children, he says, that's fine. For will I not have peace and security in my lifetime? Will living for peace and security in my lifetime, what Francis Schaeffer called personal peace and affluence, is killing our generation. We need some people who are willing to live for the guardians of the next generation and be the guardians of the next generation. I'm telling you, my friends, great. We are living, let me just cut to the chase here, because our time is short and I want to talk for 6 or 7 hours, but I know we can't do that because American Idol, after all. We are living at a moment that is unbelievable when it comes to the issue of abortion and protecting the unborn and attitudes in this country. In Missouri, they are having the lowest abortion rates they have had in 22 years. In Texas, they're having the lowest abortion rates. This is the home state of Roe v. Wade. In Texas, they're having the lowest abortion rates they've had in 12 years. National polls show that now, statistically, a majority of Americans, for the first time since Roe v. Wade, a statistical majority of Americans believe that life occurs at some point in the womb and that abortion is not ultimately the best solution. You know what's powering that? What's powering that are those crazy 20-somethings. Those 20-somethings who we call the millennials or the generation next or whatever. They don't have much of a worldview. They're kind of religious. You know, they kind of get their religion the way you catch a cold, by casual contact with strangers. You know, they sort of hammer together different religious things to create a religious worldview. But I'll tell you what, because they don't have any worldview, they believe what they see. And what's changing their generation is this ultrasound machine. They look at the pictures. They look at those coffee table books, the ones with the illumination inside of the womb. And you see those amazing pictures of the baby in there. You've seen them, the art, beautiful art books. They look in there and they go, hey, it's got toes. It's got parts. It's got a nose. It's a baby. And that's changing their perspective. And even though we have what you might call, for lack of a better term, a liberal or progressive trend in our politics in this country, we're moving that way, and a liberal and progressive trend in our theology in this country, because of the fine work of organizations like what we're here to celebrate tonight. In fact, the attitudes and the beliefs about abortion are actually one of the major trends going the opposite direction, because such a great job has been done saying to this generation, if you believe in life, believe in it from conception. Things are changing. And I want to tell you, as a guy who works in D.C., that if present trends continue in the next 36 to 48 months, I believe we're going to see a test case come up before the Supreme Court regarding Roe v. Wade, and we may see at least a partial rollback of Roe v. Wade for the first time since that ever came before the court. Isn't that amazing? Now, my friends, I want to tell you about why I care about this so much, and then I'll talk to you a little bit more about this issue in our generation. In 1957, there was a young Army wife stationed with her husband, Fort Benning, Georgia. She had had a number of miscarriages, and she had had a number of stillbirths. She found herself to be pregnant again. She was happy about it. She went to see the doctors at St. Francis Hospital in Columbus, Georgia, a Catholic hospital. The doctors, who were from outside of the hospital and outside of the Catholic community, met with her and said, you need to let us take this child because this child could cost you your life. She was devastated. She was just devastated. She sat there on that table with that paper gown that doctors make us wear. They should all spend 5 minutes in hell for making us wear those. I mean that. Sat there on that table wearing that paper gown, and into the room crept three Irish nuns, who were also nurses, not just sisters in both sense, religious sisters and medical sisters, as they used to call them, nurses and nuns at the same time. They weren't supposed to be in there, but being Irish, they didn't care. So they they went into the room, walked up to this young mother, who, by the way, not a believer of any kind, would swore later she'd never even met a Catholic in her life. Of course, that wasn't true, but I'm just talking about her religious, narrow little pagan religious worldview. These nuns said, "Young lady, if you will carry this child to term, we'll have our convent and our order praying constantly for this child." Now, this mother, as I say, was a pagan, had no religious orientation, and wouldn't have been able to tell you what Catholicism was to save her life. But she reached out for the hope that those Irish Catholic nuns held out, and both were good to their word. She carried that child to full term, and those nuns, indeed, made sure that there was a prayer vigil of some sort within their order, round the clock, for that child. And on June 28th, 1958, I was born. Because that was my mother, and that was me. And I think that worked out really, really well. Really well. Now, my friends, the point that I'm trying to make here this evening is not that we should get behind Judy and her team, because if we do, there'll be more Stephen Mansfields in the world, because the jury is still out on whether it's a good idea that one Stephen Mansfield is in the world, much less a whole lot of others. But I'm here to call you to heroic living. I'm here for you to realize that just surviving economically, that just getting the kids through high school and college and then retiring, that just living the American materialistic life, and you know this, I do not mean to be insulting, that that's not enough. It's just not enough. Most of you are people of faith. That hole in your soul that Augustine spoke about, "Lord, you have formed us for yourself, and our hearts are restless till they find their rest in thee." You found that in your faith. But what often people of faith have not done is gone ahead and pressed into the largeness of life, pressed into the great calling on their lives that they can find. You have been chosen by God to live in a generation that has the opportunity to roll back the scourge of abortion in this land, to save lives, to heal women who are hurting and desperate, to live out, to help people live out stories like Colleen's and others that we've heard about tonight in powerful ways. And my friends, I want to say to you that this is not just a battle for individual lives, as valuable as that is. We are fighting for the soul of a nation. Let me just tell you a quick statistic. I spend a lot of time ministering in Europe, largely to the American military, but sometimes to the Europeans themselves, loving Europe and having been raised there as a military brat. Do you know that in a country, you have to have a birth rate of 2.1 on average per family for the population to stay stable? It's because of deaths and so on, 2.1. You have to have a birth rate of 2.1 for the population to remain stable. America barely has that at 2.7. Just under 2.07. Europe is aborting itself to death. Europe is dying. In Italy, for example, the birth rate is 1.2, half, less than half of what it needs to be. They will lose half their population every generation. By 2050, the average person in Italy will not have a brother, a sister, an uncle, or an aunt. They are dying. And you know what's rushing in to fill that population vacuum? You know what's arising in Europe. Radical Islam. That's why we're dealing with some of the things that we are. What I'm saying is that what we're here to deal with tonight, yes, it's about these individual women. Yes, it's about these lives. Yes, it's about people who might be me or might be you in 30 or 40 or 50 or 60 years, however old we all are. But it's also about fighting for the soul of a nation, spiritually and numerically in terms of population. I wonder if you realize how important this is, how vital this is, how critical this is in our generation. And we're at a tipping point. If we can just push, if we can just go beyond the norm, if we can just do some exceptional things now, we can see a generation turned around. Now, I know what happens, and I'm going to be very brief here. I do a lot of speaking at organizations like this because I've committed my life to it and I love it, but I know what happens. People like Judy and her team, bless their hearts, they're good stewards and they're good students of how these things should work. And so every year they figure out, according to the statistics and the psychology and what's going on and how the experts advise, and they're wise to get consultants, they find out that they need to package the needs. Every crisis pregnancy center does this every year. They want to raise a little bit more money than last year, and they want to add an addition on the building, or they want to get a phone system, or they want to hire a new staff member. You know what I'm talking about. Every good nonprofit thinks of new ways to add just a little bit, like they should, as good stewards, but they keep it within the range of what you, people like you, are normally willing to give as an increase each year. And my friends, that is good, and it's valuable, and it's wise management, but I'm telling you, we're at a tipping point, and we cannot do business as usual this year. We cannot. I believe with all my heart that if we will give and give radically, that if we will realize the tipping point that we are living in, if we will realize our calling to this, our calling to conduct ourselves financially and in terms of our labors and our lives in such a way that the unborn are protected and that lives are saved and changed and made whole, I believe that we are just about at a point of actually reversing this trend in our generation and modeling something magnificent for a dark and hurting world. I am thrilled with that. Now, nobody told you when you came here tonight that you were coming to watch a movie, okay? Nobody lied to you about why you're here. We have you here because we want to celebrate what's happening and because we want to call you to give and to give radically. And I have no problem pushing that button. I love what Judy and her team does. I love what's happening. Have you seen what's in that brochure you've been given? Unbelievable the things that they are accomplishing. Magnificent. And tonight I want you to give. And I want you to give radically. If you filled out a check while you were at home because you knew if you came tonight, somebody like me would be here whipping you into a frenzy and you would write a bigger check than you wanted to, you tear that sucker up or give it to me and write you a new one. That's how we talk in Tennessee. You write you a new one. Y'all quit, all right? My friends, tonight is a tipping point. And I know the economy's tight and I know what's happening, but I will tell you what. Now is a moment, and I don't want to get weird with any kind of promising the blessing of God. That's not what I'm talking about. But I'll tell you what I want to do with my money, regardless of what the economic times are. I want to give according to what's on the heart of God. And don't you know that in the same way that we are told at times in the Bible that Jesus was looking down, or God was intently looking in a certain place at a certain time in history, that he is intently looking at America now in terms of the issue of the unborn, and he is calling his people to rally and to give their talents, give their money. I always ask questions about past giving, and I've asked these of Judy and her team, and you've been a generous people, but I'll tell you what, we can blow past that tonight, and we need to. And I want to ask you to give, and I want you to ask you to give radically. And I want to ask you to give not just because you came to a little event and you saw some books and you heard some singing. I want to ask you to give because you have a sense of the weightiness tonight that we are living at a moment where we can turn this thing around. Final comment. Many of you know, because you've looked at the bio and read my books, that I was embedded with the troops in Iraq. I won't get into those stories. But on the last day that I was there, my driver, who'd been with me the whole time, hadn't said anything but cuss words the whole time we were there, turned to me in the Humvee as we were going back to the airport, and he said, "You know, they tried to kill my generation with this war." Now, I thought he was going to complain about Bush and the war. That's fine. He has the right. If you're serving in uniform, you can complain to me anytime you want. So I was going to let him fly. But then he said, "And they tried to kill my generation with abortion." I was stunned. He had not shown a thimbleful of spiritual sense the whole month I'd been over there. And then he said, "My generation must be made for something magnificent." That's what he said. And he's right. And I want to stand with you to be guardians of that generation and the next generation on the rise as they go forth to engage the enemies, all the enemies of faith and natural enemies in the gates. This is a wonderful time to be alive. You are called to be here for such a time as this. Join the battle with us. It's an honor to be with you. God bless you.